Okay, we have a large line of people here with imponderable questions, which I'm sure you will deal with expeditiously, as usual. So I will let the first questioner, Fred Lomax, to ask his question.
Yes, hello, Simon, and thank you so much for fabulous knowledge. My question has to do with the electromagnetic field or shield that those who are enslaving the planet have basically used their technology to entrap us. And in that question, to elaborate on its source, the energy sources, either the moon or Mars or terrestrial here, and the connection that could have with the idea and concept that I am in a holodeck.
Hello, Fred. Have you seen The Matrix?
Yeah.
Have you seen The Matrix movie?
Yeah. Yeah.
No?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh.
The second one, Matrix Reloaded. After the Keymaker is shot dead, Neo opens the door, and you've already been told by the Oracle that this is Source. As soon as he goes through the door, you see a star field. Now you need, if you've got DVD or Blu-ray, you need to freeze frame it, because just for a very few frames, you will see a grid network right across the stars. And this is the Polish brothers who made the film, who have very close connections with the CIA, telling you that to get to Source, you have to get through the grid. Now, I say to people who come to me via my website, and I do soul readings for them, that you know you've made it when you look down on the Earth, you see the Earth, and you see it covered in a grid like a net. And that's exactly what The Matrix was telling you. And that was made in 1999-2000. So I hate to say it, but anything that's coming out of Hollywood, please be careful of it. Because whenever you see a near-death experience portrayed on the cinema, you will see a corridor, a door opening, and a white light. And you're encouraged to go towards the white light. If you go into a food mall, then you see one of those things on the wall that traps all the flies and then zaps them. Then if you've seen them, it's exactly the same principle. So, what you need to do is to say, I want to go to Source. I wish to go home. And every time you see the bright light, and just turn yourself from it in your mind and say, I wish to go home. Now, it might be that somebody comes to collect you. And remember what we spoke about before, you have to trust yourself. Is this really Jesus who has come to collect you to take you? Is it really your mother? Or is it a holograph? I'm going to exactly use the term you have. So trust yourself. This is a form of enslavement and entrapment. But if you practice every day from now onwards saying to your physical mind, I wish to go to Source, when your physical body does die, that will be imprinted on you, and the first thing you will think after your physical body is dead is, I wish to go to Source. So this is the first training you need to get yourself into. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm on my tippy toes. Greetings. What suggestions would you have for agents who have incarnated into a physical vehicle to remember their mission?
That's actually a very good question. When we reincarnate on the planet, our soul memory is partially wiped, not entirely. There is no other explanation for a 4 or 5 year old child who can play the piano and has never read music. There is no other explanation for a 4 or 5 year old child who can be a chess grandmaster. What's happening is the soul is remembering something from a past life. When you become spiritual, you begin to open a connection between your soul and your organic brain. When that happens, your organic brain will begin to draw down memory. And part of that memory is what we're doing here. There are two reasons why we incarnate on the planet Earth, generally. One is because we have situations that we have to learn and overcome and come to terms with that. Secondly, because we couldn't stand the situation here and we needed to come here. When you are in a higher dimension, you have telepathy, you have telekinesis. There is no problem that can fox you. But what does hurt people is emotional feelings. And so some people choose to incarnate here. They give everything up and come here. And the reason for that is there is no telepathy generally here, no telekinesis. If you have a problem, it is in your face. And the only way you deal with it is here. And if you can do that, then 100 years on this planet is worth 100,000 years anywhere else, because your spiritual development be immense if you can reach what you need to reach. But people to incarnate on this planet, they have to be really pushed, driven, either because they wish some enlightenment for themselves, or they are so saddened by the horrible way that the majority are being treated by the minority. And so they come here to help. The problem is, when we all generally arrive here, we cannot remember who we are or what our plans were. And it's around about the age 50 that we begin to work out who we were and what we're supposed to do. So half of our life is gone. Blessed are those children, 3 and 4 years old, who remember who they are, because they've got their whole physical life to get that done, to get that work, and they have a great head start. And that's what star children, indigo children are, because they are waking up at a very early age. Okay?
My concern is about Terra, planet, and the things that the Illuminati or whoever is taking and taking and taking from this Earth. And if this Earth is our plane of demonstration, it seems to be others. The Earth, I'm asking, it can take care of itself, right? And it's the gas, the oil, the fracking, the whole thing, the atmosphere, and on. And so I'm assuming no matter what happens, we humans who have the ability inside and whatever else we have, gifts we have, are working on us. What about Terra?
Right. Couldn't fully hear the question because the audio wasn't that good.
Okay.
You asked about fracking. Did you also ask about Terra?
Terra is my question. What's going on with Terra? Because we humans are... We have our job, but many of the beings on this planet are taking and taking from Earth and the atmosphere, the oil, the gas. When we had Tesla, there's so many things that are already here that we just... So I'm asking, is Terra taking care of herself? She's a plain demonstration, seems to be interesting to many, many beings. Terra is going to be okay, is this correct?
Okay. You know, I've got 9 cats. Although you've only seen one tonight. But when I go to the vets, I see posters up that say, killer fleas. How many fleas has your cat got? You need to buy this. Or I'll see a picture of a 7-year-old girl crying and a dead rabbit in her hand, and it's saying, you should have got it vaccinated. For years and years and years, the corporate system has used fear to make you buy something. So if you don't put money away for your funeral, how are you going to be buried? So they're only using a tried and trusted method, which is if we put fear into human hearts, you'll stop having the time to think about the truth, to think about yourself. And if we bombard you and make you such a busy person, you'll never have time to meditate. You will always be reacting to the situations we give you. We then will control you because we will set the agenda. So that's partly the fear. The second fear is literally the energy that a human being creates when it is fearful. That is energy for these creatures. And also, thirdly, finally, if you are fearful, then you are open to suggestions from others. So in other words, we need to tap your phone lines because we think that there's a terrorist in your community. Now, if you're all fearful of that, you are more likely to agree. So those are the three reasons why fear is used. You talked about fracking. Yes, fracking is also a very important element because the earth creates two forms of energy. One are the lines across the earth, all the sacred sites, but the other is the underground water courses. Just as your human bodies have blood in your veins, so earth transmits coded energy through its underground water courses. And the fracking is designed to release the poison chemicals into that to begin to stop the earth communicating. Because humans and the earth are like that. The earth and the human race are connected. So as the earth evolves, so human consciousness evolves. Now the bad guys know that, and their plan is to get the fracking oil or the gas, but also to pollute the atmosphere, to pollute the underground water course. So yes, you're absolutely right, and that's why we mustn't be fearful. And you can actually start to train yourselves. I'm going to give you some exercises to do. Not the sort of exercises you think I'm going to give you. You come up home and you drop something in the kitchen or you knock a glass of wine over. Your natural reaction is to shout or cuss or swear. Don't. Just say, that's a nuisance. Because if you can bring your energy response, instead of traditional humans are like this, peaking up and down, up and down. If you can level it, then you are not producing energy that negatives can use. And you are also disciplining yourself in the way that you will react when the television tells you that something has gone off. Instead of that immediate panic, you will just treat it in the same way. So your soul isn't the problem, it's your bodies and minds. Because these are the things that have been programmed at the moment we were born. Before we became fully awake, we were stuck in front of the television. So you can start to train yourself. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Greetings, Simon. I'm so happy to have this opportunity to see you here today and be a part of this. I have a question about going back to the Morgellons and the nanobots. I know that Allison has found that one of the things that works is glutathione and vitamin C and one other thing.
And I'm curious whether, and then also you suggest, you talked about having a clean body, free of the bugs, the pathogens, as well as our consciousness work. I'm wondering if there's some other, like, mechanical device, such as a rife or frequency machine or an ionic foot spa type machine that would also get rid of these things and flush them out of the body. And I'm asking the question not for me so much or us here, but for people who will be seeing this who don't have the awareness of these things, if there's something specific that you could recommend.
Right. If people don't have the awareness of these things, it's potential because their consciousness is not yet evolved. But if you are saying that you know people and you wish to help them, then that's good. And we really must try and educate people and help them. I cannot recommend any type of machine. I know the machines you're referring to, and I understand they have had some good results. But I can't recommend that you go and put your body to a machine. That's a choice that you have to make. I can recommend spiritual and energy type healings, but it is your personal choice to rely on a mechanical device, no matter how that works. The best way for that is, of course, to find somebody who has been cured by using those devices. That is the best bet. Look, I am not going to recommend you do it. I am going to recommend that you find these people who run them, and then you ask yourself if it's something you want to do.
Greetings, Simon. My name is David. My question is along the lines of a discussion we've had so far. There's been some discussion.
Rather like a giraffe.
Thank you, I think. There's been some talk about implants this day. My question's along those lines. You have mentioned in previous interviews that although you have an ongoing relationship with the mantids, your body has not been implanted. Instead, you have a portal between you and them, which maintains a connection. Would you elaborate, please, on what you are able to do with this portal? I was personally speculating that it may help you to access information when you are asked a question, simply because I have never seen you at a loss to answer any question over the course of many years.
I'm a very different sort of creature. I did a television, live television interview for Breakfast Television in Britain 2 years ago, and it is on the internet. We don't have anything like the population you guys have, but something like 12 million people watch this television program every breakfast time. And they count you down. I don't know if anyone's ever done live television, but in Britain they count you down 30 seconds to go, 20 seconds to go. So I was sitting on the chair with the two interviewers opposite me, and then one of the makeup girls came up to me, and they're very, very brilliant. They have these belts which they wear around them, and there's brushes and powders. And the guy was shouting like 15 seconds to go, and she got the big puffball, she goes towards me and says, "You're not sweating." So I'm different. The portal is important because If I didn't have it, I would have to what's called channel. Now, when you channel off-world entity, it can be packed. It can be tapped. And sometimes information can be put through that is not what you think it is. A portal cannot be hacked into. It can't be tapped. A portal either exists or it doesn't. So the point of the portal was to allow real-time back and forth information that could not be corrupted either way. Yes, when I'm asked a question, I'm able to draw on a library, that's the best word I would describe it. It's not necessarily the Akashic records, it's not necessarily DNA memory, but it is a source of information which I can draw on. That I've had ever since I can remember. I remember at school as a 6 or 7 year old child in a religious educational lesson, answering questions to the teacher was asking the class in relation to parables. And I just seemed to have a complete knowledge of the life of Jesus Christ and the parables that went with it. Although I came from a family that was not religious in the true sense of the word. So yes, it's a hyperspeed two-way portal that allows both pictures, still and video, and written communication, no period words. Thank you.
Simon, thank you so much for being present with us today. You mentioned in your April newsletter that a Zionist regime hit squad recently attempted assassinations of both President Putin and President Obama, but they were foiled. Also, that 10 American senators were arrested in connection with this. I tried to find information about senators being arrested from the internet, but if it was ever there, it was completely scrubbed away. Is there any evidence available concerning the arrests, and do you have anything you can add about this subject at this time?
I can say things because I myself am a Jew. So therefore, because I am a Jew, I can talk about Israel and Zionism without the elite turning on me. You will not find any information on the internet because those 10 senators have been released. Because how could you possibly bring senators to the judge for an attempt for the death of a president? It would bring the whole administration down. The object of the arrests of the senators was to put them into house arrest for a number of hours so they couldn't communicate with anybody, to break up that communication network. That was the principle. None of them went to a police station. That wasn't the sort of arrest that occurred.
It was for their protection.
No.
It was to prevent them talking to each other.
Yeah.
Because at that time, nobody knew who was the ringleader who was organizing the others. The hit squad was designed to take out President Obama because President Obama was refusing to carry out some of the instructions he was given and had basically turned around and said he wasn't going to go any further down the road. The reason to try to take out Putin was because Putin was seen as the biggest block to the New World Order. You must understand that 3 years ago, Putin removed the Rothschild banking system from Russia. The Rothschilds did not have a bank anywhere in Russia now. Because Putin now is just not taking any orders from anybody from the Western side, it was considered that he would be better off being killed, and they were kind of saying he was killed by terrorists. So that was the point. But you have to also understand that this Zionist group did not act on the instructions of the Israeli government. They are a completely separate group. If you think how the Jesuits are within the Vatican, so the Zionists are within the Jewish state. So there will be no evidence, because to bring that forward would be to destroy the whole trust that the people have in the system of Capitol Hill.
Simon, I would like to know what the Red Dragon Society, their relationship to the new BRICS economic system, and also about the TTP, the new thing that Obama is talking about. You know, there's a new, the TTP, something like that. It's the trade agreement. And a lot of people are very concerned about it.
The first question, there's the Red Dragon Society and the White Dragon Society. These two are very old families. Both sides of a family could be split, so if you have two sons, one could be in the Red Dragon group, one could be in the White Dragon group. Originally a Chinese organization, not exclusively so. This is where the term the White Hats sometimes comes from. The Dragon Societies are not evil in the sense of the word. They are a cultural organization that is designed to create power and money for the families and supporters of those families. But they have become drawn into a wider argument outside of their own families. They exert tremendous power over countries like Korea, Vietnam, Malaysia, all of that area. The tribal agreements you're talking about, if I understand correctly, is a system to maintain America with its closest trading allies, where you don't necessarily use money, but you do favors for people. So, for instance, Canada is expected to be part of a very close trading situation for America if the BRICS system comes into effect. And it means that America could take water, well, it's taking water from the Great Lakes, as you know. Most of the major cities receive water now from Canada's lakes, but they are paid for. But under a trade agreement, where America doesn't have the money that it has at the moment, then it be able to take this and not pay for it. Mexico also is being pressurized to come into the system, as are some South American countries. So America is attempting to create a regional vacuum within which no other places can come in, but there isn't a free trade of money. In other words, Argentina, Peru, whatever countries might feel a connection to the Americas would be expected to give, but not necessarily receive. That is because your country and my country has no gold left. There's no gold. You know, I went public with the newsletter 2 months ago, making it clear to non-Americans that a few years ago, America defaulted on its interest payment to China. And that was a shock to many non-Americans, because the pictures they have from the 1950s and 60s of Fort Knox with all the gold bars, and the very fact that many places like Boston Harbor have been not sold but given away to countries like China simply because America couldn't pay its bills. Now, The elite know all this, but the reason the charade still carries on is because as long as enough people think that those zeros on a computer screen are real money, there is profit to be made. The day that those zeros on the screen are no longer seen as real money, that is the day when your dollar will devalue down to 10 cents and my British pound will devalue down to 1/10 of its value. But that is the time when what the alternative media are using the word reset. Even the alternative media are frightened to use the word, which I'm going to use now, which is devaluation. The currencies have to devalue before they can be reset. So even the alternative media runs scared of saying gold. But there's no choice if we have no gold. And those of you who have read your history know that in the great dark days of the Depression, the government insisted that citizens who had gold had to go in to the banks and hand it over and be paid a set price for it. As soon as that had done, what did they do? Double the price of gold.
Yeah.
So all these people who hoarded gold found that they'd been duped. So when people say to me, should I buy gold? I say, no, don't bother. You're much better off growing food.
Yeah.
Hello, Simon.
Hi.
You spoke about the fact that there is an agreement that the presidents have to sign off with the alien group, the second alien group, that worked out a deal with America, who speaks on behalf of the rest of the planet on alien matters. And you also talked about the fact that there was an attempt to assassinate Hillary Clinton, but they didn't do that. They weren't successful for whatever reason. Now, there's a timeline that Hillary Clinton could be the next president of the United States. And I wanted to know, to understand, what would be the implications of that, since they weren't successful in taking her out. What's the implication of her being the next president in 2016?
Right. Can I just ask the audience, is everybody aware that there was an assassination attempt on Hillary Clinton a couple of years back?
No. Yeah. Yeah.
No. The reason that that attempt was made was because the individual saw something that so shocked him that he felt that he wasn't killing a human, he was killing something else.
Yeah.
It makes no difference whether Jeb Bush or Hillary Clinton are elected. Remember what I told you, presidents are chosen from the age of 5, probably earlier.
Yeah.
So those in control have hedged their bets. They don't mind which one of them gets sick, because both are both are bloodline, although Hillary Clinton is more scary. I have a picture of President Bush and his wife standing beside the Queen of England at a meeting some while ago. And George Bush was looking like a schoolboy. In actual fact, the reason I've got the photograph is because he's doing the devil sign with his hand down by his side. And it's a great honor for these people to be next to someone like the Queen, because they are all very closely connected. So, if George Bush felt the need to stand by the Queen, whoever is elected as president will feel the urge to visit Great Britain very quickly to also get the approval of the Queen, But bear in mind that the next president is going to have to face a dramatic change in his or her country in the next 2 to 3 years. So, to me, matter which one of these becomes president of your great country, because whoever has it has got to
have... I'm British, by the way. I'm British.
And it is actually a great country. The United States is the greatest country anywhere on the planet because it has the potential to make changes that no other country can do. That is why everything happens in America of great importance, because the people of America can actually bring about change in a way that no other peoples in any other country can do. That's why you have so much control on you, because you're so powerful as a people, but most of you don't know it. You know it. Most people don't know it. So what I would say to you is, it matters not a dollar who wins the next presidential election. What's important is what happens in 2 years' time when they're in office. What part of Britain did you come from originally?
No, I'm actually from Bermuda.
Oh, Bermuda. Okay, so you're from the islands. That's lovely.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Hi, Simon.
Hi.
As you've spoken, you've spoken about a shift happening for us in 2017.
Could you speak into the microphone? Because
yeah.
I can't hear.
Okay. You've spoken about a shift happening for us in. I'll start again. You've spoken about a shift happening for us in 2017, and I wanted to know what would life look like for us in the energy field after the shift, and how would we be affected here globally?
Right. In 2012,
yeah.
We as a race, passed through the most important point that we would have done for 2,000 years. And we set in motion something that cannot be reversed. So I've always said that we will get to where we're going to. The question is, how much damage will we take on the way? The shift is not a physical shift. The new age has completely misunderstood, and I'm as guilty as everybody else, because I use the word ascension. And I use the word ascension because that is what the general public understand. And part of my job, I believe, is to try to wake up the general public. But it is not an ascension, it is a pouring down. Between 220 and 250,000 years ago, a group of reptilians tricked the human race and took away 10 strands of DNA. Humans naturally have 12 strands of DNA.
Wow.
So we were left with two physical strands, which made us intelligent enough to work, but not intelligent enough to understand higher things, and basically to see the prison warders that were around us. Around every decent, good living creature are 10 strands of energy DNA. There is a 13th, which we call a metagene. This is the tumbler code that controls the 12 strands. They wish to return to the human body. As they return to the human body and we action each of these strands, we then become more psychic and we become more aware and we begin to perceive into other dimensions. So when you get glimpses of, it's rather like a heat haze. You know, you see a long road, and then you see the heat rising off the road. Well, you'll begin to see things like this, but it's not a heat haze. You are perceiving into another dimension. There will be other times where you will see through objects, and you'll begin to see these creatures that live in these other dimensions that appear to be in the same room as you. That's the physicalist. The spiritualist is the connection through the DNA to understand the greater cause of the universe, who you are, what you are, what your connection is. That will completely liberate the mind and put you in a position where you will have no fear. That you know that if your body dies, you don't die, because your soul will live on. It will completely empower man and woman on this planet. And it is because of that that the elites do not want this ascension program, because then you will not do what you're told to do. So the next 2 years will see a great transformation. At the moment, there are about 4 million people who have completely taken on the 12 strands of DNA. Other people are in the process, 6, 7, 8. There are many millions of humans now. And if you are psychic, it's probably because you are connecting with your strands of DNA. And I told you, I do soul readings. And occasionally when I have a person who comes to me, I do it all on Skype because, as you know, I don't fly. But when I see them, I can look at them and say, you know, you've got 8 strands or you've got 9 strands. And it's really exciting because the human race is developing. The problem is that so many people are still stuck in this physical world. They want something to happen. They want the heavens to open. You know, was it Moses or Abraham who had a burning bush? And the burning bush spoke to him. Because humans need physical things. You know, God send me a sign. But we're talking about energy. We're not talking about physical things. And we have to lose the connection with the physical to build the spiritual and to understand that we are moving away from a physical body living creature into something a little bit more different. Now, when you go to college and you're taught what you're taught, what I'm saying is very difficult for many people to understand. And that's all part of the plan, to keep everybody stuck in a position so that they cannot evolve. But you know what? Human spirit is so strong that it demands to evolve. It demands to be free. That's the great thing about humankind. It fights for freedom. And that's what every one of you is doing in your own way. You are fighting for freedom. And, you know, if everyone can copy your example, then we'll have a bloodless revolution. And that's actually what I want, a bloodless revolution. I know.
I'd like to ask if how the soul would be affected with this shift if energy is now pouring onto us as we begin to open up and reattach our DNA strands.
Did you say how the skull would be affected?
Soul.
So, your soul was made by God. It's perfect. It will not be affected. What will happen is that the programming in your brain, your organic brain, will then start to do what the soul is saying. At the moment, for most people on this planet, there is an argument between their soul, which wants to do one thing, and their organic brain, which is controlled, wants to do something else. When the shift comes, the brain will do what the soul wants.
Yay.
I have a second part to this question, is that if the illusion on Earth is held here on this planet by holographic projections from Saturn and the Moon, what changes can we expect from the 2017 shift for our holographic projection year and how we are held in place?
Are you referring to the control system? Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Well, the bad news is that the control system will still be here. The good news is that the hope is that human consciousness will evolve to such a high level that that control system will not be able to engage with it. I want you to imagine my hand here is human consciousness, and this is the control level. If we can evolve beyond the control level, it just won't be able to engage with us, because the level of our knowledge and understanding will be as such that we will perceive everything. We'll see everything. Therefore, lies are lies and truth is truth. And once you know something is a lie, you don't engage with it, and it's out in the open. So the control system will still be there, but we will see it for what it is.
Can I ask one more question?
I'm not the boss there. Whoever's the boss there.
We've got the book just ready to go out soon, but she's still okay.
Thank you. I have one more about the different characteristics of blood types. We as humans here, we have different blood types, A, B, B, O, and A, B, and O. And I was wondering if there's any connection with the blood types that we carry here with different star lineages.
Oh, that's interesting. No one's asked me that question before. Illuminati families will usually have rhesus negative and rhesus positive running through their bloodlines. There are two spots of Illuminati on this planet. There are the old Illuminati and the new Illuminati. The new Illuminati come from the Renaissance period, Italy, 15th century, 14th, 15th, 16th century. These are the new guys of Illuminati. The old guys trace right back Anunnaki, right back to Sumeria and beyond. When you physically look at a bloodline family, you would expect to see rhesus negative blood somewhere there. Now, when a soul incarnates in a body, it can be either from the human group, that's an earth human, or it can be a higher human. These are my terminologies. These are humans who come from other star systems, or it can be non-human. All right, let's say I've got a reptilian soul that wishes to incarnate in a human body. The energy frequency around that human baby that's in its mother's womb must resonate at a frequency that is equal to the resonation frequency of the reptilian soul. It cannot put a reptilian soul in a standard human body because the frequency is different, and the human body will attempt to eject the reptilian soul. Remember that the reptilian soul are not native to this planet, and if you put a non-native soul into a native body, there will be resistance. So many mothers talk about something happening to their babies. Maybe they have a miscarriage, or the child is taken away and seems to come back again. The frequency of that individual baby that's growing will be altered to suit the soul. So if you have a reptilian soul, I would expect somewhere in the family line to be probably a rhesus negative or rhesus positive. If you are a Palladian soul, then your frequency will be different. So the bloodline generally for human, higher human groups can be anything. But if you are reptilian, I would expect there to be rhesus negative in the family line. Okay?
Thank you very much.
for all of you. It's about time that we let Simon go to sleep. Yeah. Play over there. There's about 100 questions that.
Well, just keep going. Keep
going. Yay.
Keep going. Behavior and was going to hold back until you came for a return visit. But since you said that, oh boy. The lines you can see are starting to get a little bit longer here. And thank you very much. Okay, gang, it's all yours again.
Hi. I personally had about 3 pages of questions to talk to you about. Fortunately, many of my friends and colleagues here have asked a lot of them already. But I try to think, well, what would be the thing that I would like to ask you about if I only got to ask you one thing? And what came to my mind was, what would you and your mentor friends, wise choice, by the way, of compassion, like to say to this group in particular, and all those who may watch this on YouTube, that maybe you haven't said before, or you'd like to say in a more concise way, because you've given a lot of wise advice already. So what would you like to say, and what would your context like to say to us?
I always try to be concise. I hope I don't waffle. When I'm invited to the radio show or something like this, every minute is precious. I don't want to tell you what I had for breakfast, or what I did today, or what film I watched, because that is just pointless. I have to message across. I have to try and get you to start doing your own research, and I have to try and wake up all those millions of people that just don't know the truth. So I try to engage in a way that is relevant and is understood by those people. And that's why I prefer the questions, because I am dealing with you individually. But when I talk as a group, then my points have to be more general. And all I'm going to say in answer to that question is, you are all wonderful creatures. You are the most incredible creation. And if you work together, you can achieve anything, anything at all. Work together to believe in yourselves and to know that ultimately you will come through this and you will survive. And having that belief will give you that strength, and having that strength will give you that belief. So don't be intimidated, don't be frightened. Form your networks, form your groups, support each other, and when you are attacked in terms of your belief, and they try and turn you away from what you believe, you must be strong and resolute. And just as Jesus Christ, the night of the Last Supper, who could have turned and run away, but didn't, don't turn your back on your own truth. Don't compromise yourselves. Because literally at the 11th hour, then the truth will come out. So that's my answer to you. Okay. Now I'm going to be fearful and say, you said you had 300 questions.
And I wouldn't burden you with all of that. But I am curious if you would share with us more of your vision of the future. You talked about it being a bloodless transition, and I like that idea. And you've talked about the 12 or 13 strands of DNA, yeah. And you've talked about the interconnectedness and the, I don't want to go on with all recapping the things you've already said, I mean, now, but in previous videos. But I'd like to hear more of how you see the future and your place in it, and what excites you about it? What are you in love with?
The important thing is that nobody can see the future, not in the sense that you mean. We can, those of us who can see, have an indication. But that's what makes it special. Because if we knew exactly what was going to happen, we could change it and alter it. But because we can't exactly know the truth, there is that element of doubt. And that element of doubt is important because it gives us free will. If I knew the future, I would have no free will because I know the way we were going. But because I don't know fully how we're going, I then have free will to make choices. That's what it's about, making choices. So my vision, you already know what that is. My vision is what you have as a vision. What's my role on that? That will be decided by the people on this planet. Once the job on this planet is done, I'm gone. I don't need to be here. But how long I stay will depend on how clean the transition is after the changes. Because there is danger that when one empire falls, before another comes up, there is a vacuum. And a negative force is going to attempt to gain control while that vacuum is in place. So it is a difficult transition period.
Isn't that what's happening now?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I have two questions, but I'd like to thank you first so very, very much, dear heart, for you being on the planet with us at this time. And my heart is so full that you are here. And thank you for the enlightenment. Thank you. My first question is, for the first time since Kennedy, I've gotten excited about a gentleman who's going to run for president. And that's Bernie Sanders from Vermont. And what I'd like to know is he what he says he is at this time? He's saying things that are very, very close to a lot of what we have been saying here as a general populace for many years. And he's gotten a lot of strength and courage to come out with it. And I really want to believe in him.
I'll answer that one first. The answer is yes, he is genuine. The reason that he's been allowed and will be allowed to stand is because the elite believe their control of the multimedia will ensure that he doesn't get the coverage and that they will be able to destroy him, his credibility. So they believe that the media will not carry his message.
Thank you so much for that. Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders are such wondrous people, and I wondered why they were allowed to say what they were saying. Thank you. My second question is, what are you surprised at what question we didn't ask?
I am never surprised by the questions that I'm not asked. I am surprised by the depth of questions that I'm asked. In other words, that the knowledge that many people show through their questions shows me that they are evolving at a spiritual level at a faster rate than they were 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Isn't that wonderful? Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. It is so wonderful to have you and to look at you that you have ears in your heart. And Yeah, I have a very simple question. If we do things, every daily things, every moment what we do, have a coffee, do the food, and we could be so great that we don't fight against it, that we in love with this moment, then, and we try that, and we learn that, and we want to do that, more as anything, do the thing we do in the moment with love, then isn't the question 16 or 17 stretching, because then there is no time, because it is in no time, and isn't that by themselves the gate to the love, to our greatness in our heart, with any support of the great beings?
If you consider my left hand here and my right hand to be the reality within which we will exist, the question that you've just asked has not been understood by a quarter of your audience. I will now explain so that they understand. When you move beyond that, time doesn't move. On this planet, we see time in a line, linear. What you're telling me is time moves either in a circle or in a figure of eight, and time doesn't have a constraint on it. We move outside of this reality when it appears that time stands still and all things are possible. When you talk about love, the importance of love is the acceptance of everything without preconditions. The problem on this planet is that I'll give you something, but you give me something back. When I run some of my symposiums and conferences, what the cameras don't show, because they only film me when I'm speaking, but when I'm not speaking, I have a table which I lay out, and I put gifts on the table. And then we have a question and answer session. And if I like the answer, doesn't mean it's right. If I like the answer, then I say to the person, come up and choose a gift. And the struggle in that person, because they want to give me something. This is the conditioning. They take a DVD or a vase or something like that, which I've got there, and the struggle in them to take something, because we're so conditioned that we have to give and receive. And I say, no, it's a present, you take it. And I do it because I educate my audience that this is what love is. It is giving without expecting something in return. So, my darling, you are operating at a very high level. You are almost now out of the loop. You are out of the control element, and the problem is that when you meet a lot of humans, they will not understand what you're saying, and they will say you've gone nuts. But that is because your level of knowledge and your spiritual ability is now to the point that this world is irrelevant to you, and the control system is totally irrelevant. Unfortunately, it isn't, because we are stuck in a 3D matrix, and we still have to have food. We still have to pay the rent. We still have to do this and do that, because we are still in the control point. But your head, through your heart and your soul, has left that control element. So thank you. It's lovely to meet you.
Thank you so much, Simon. My question relates to many of us who have been working spiritually on learning to be present and in the now and not have our emotions turn on the neurological emotions that we store in our brain that keep us in the neural net. when we're present, we're stimulating, I believe, the pineal gland. We're stimulating opening our brain so that the corpus callosum, the fissures in between, are connecting our right and left hemispheres. And in doing that, we're also affecting the ventricle system, and we're opening up possibly between the pituitary and the pineal. Can you add anything or give me some information about this?
When a soul enters a body, it goes into a partnership. I've never ever wanted someone to see a soul separate from the body. It is a partnership. And we talked earlier that the cleaner your body, the more pure your body, because the soul was created by Source, God. Your body was, but your body's been polluted. And so by removing these pollutants, you actually create your body into a transmitting and receiving device so that you can communicate in a way that we really can't communicate as we should at the moment. So your chakras are important, and it should never be forgotten that Adolf Hitler gave fluoride to all the prisoners in all the prison camps in Germany. Not because he cared about the people as teeth, but he wanted to block up the pineal gland. And that is why fluoride is added to most waters in America, because they wish to prevent your psychic abilities and your ability to connect to Source. Because when you connect to Source, you take yourself out of the control system. So you're absolutely right, and there's so much that we can do to bring our bodies back to that position. And, you know, you obviously understand that, and that's what you're doing.
Thank you. And will that open up more of our DNA once we are doing that?
The DNA activation is separate. I want you to imagine a television set. That is the body and the DNA. If your aerial is substandard, your message, your picture quality is poor. Mm. If you get and clear your aerial, you get a direct feed from Source. That is the connection between the pineal and the rest of you. It is your antenna, your aerial, that sends but also projects.
Thank you so much.
Hi there. Recently, Tutankhamun's DNA was decoded. The Y chromosome was the R1B, which has its greatest concentration in the British Isles. And currently, I think the population around Egypt is less than 1%. So I wonder if you had any explanation as to why Pharaonic Egypt had that haplogroup, and why the concentration, the greatest concentration, is in the British Isles.
Yeah. It's not widely known that Jesus and his family spent time in Britain. But there is a tradition for important people, I'm using the word loosely, important people in the world to visit Britain. That is why American presidents come to Britain, and I talk later why they stand next to the Queen. Now, not so long ago, President Obama came to Britain just before Christmas because we have a very important archaeological site here called Stonehenge. And they had found an even older Stonehenge underneath it. The very first person who visited it wasn't a British person, it was President Obama. What would bring a president all the way from America to look at a bunch of stones? The point is that there is a tradition that rulers are tracing back their DNA and their energy to a part of the world that was connected. We may call it Lumeria, we may call it Atlantis, but Britain to this day is still called the Magical Isle. We are an island, it's still called Magical Isle. And many, many races can trace a history to this country. That is why we are a tiny country, smaller than Texas. But this country, before your country became dominant, this country dominated the world. And there's a very important history here. So I'm not at all surprised that many, many people, and you talk about Tutankhamun, can trace the history to this country. That is why America and Britain are very, very close, and what happens in one country happens in another country. So we can then go back to the Exodus, when the Jews left Egypt, and we can speculate on where some of these people can trace their own genetic DNA. It is no surprise I live in Britain.
Hello, Chris. I'm to make an effort to be here because at that point, you don't want to ask the question for me. Anyway, first of all, Simon, I'm so surprised that we can have this conversation, if we can call it like that, so direct and sincere, because there are many beings that wouldn't like to ask to have this kind of exchange. I know that we are protected, and I want to believe myself more and more. I'm not protected from the back, but I'm protected from inside, first of all. So I guess, of course, you also have, I heard something that you are protected by other beings, of course, coming from where you come. I imagine. That's not a question. That's just a statement. Now, the question that I wanted to ask, and it's funny because you've been touching a few words, and please don't throw shoes at me. I'm just asking something that I've been confronted to twice in my life, and it's kind of out of this world, really. But I have to know it, yeah. The first one, I even broke with the person that mentioned that because he was convinced of that. But this time it came again, and I just wanted to say, you know, like, no, I mean, this is just crazy. But knowing what's going on in this world and what they are doing to us, I think we have to be very open-minded. I consider everything. So it is that there are more and more Germans, and among them scholars, serious people, who say that the Holocaust didn't exist in the extent that we were taught that it happened. Doesn't mean that some horrible things didn't happen, but not in that extent, that they didn't exterminate like millions of Jewish peoples and whatever, you know. So is this possible? If it was, I mean, it's horrible. First of all, and what would be the implications? I mean, they made a country that was a powerful country, feel extremely guilty for crimes that they didn't have committed themselves. It implicates that country, Germany in this case, is still paying in money and all kinds of things to Israel, but we know it's not Israel in this case, it's not the population, it would be the Zionist, Khazarian regime, whatever you want. So is this true? Because we, even the whole world, like this, even myself, being just a neighbor of Germany, I also felt guilty for this horrible, what shall I say, crime. So is this true? Is this, was that a lie? Was it like a false? I mean, if they managed to make a whole world
believe that 9/11 was done by people who didn't do it, so why wouldn't they be doing, I mean, lying already at that time? There were less ways of communication at that time than that we have now, and those people are still swearing that this happened like it happened, and so on. I mean, so many folks have flagged that, I mean, so what's your comment on that? It's huge.
Jesus said, is it a greater crime to kill one person or 100 people? If you look at the original news bulletins when the American military got into Germany, the horror from these camps was so bad that the American soldiers, not the politicians, the soldiers were so shocked that they wanted to show the local people in Germany what had happened. And there are archived films of ordinary people being taken through and seeing the most horrible situations. I tell you how many millions of people died. I can tell you that companies like IBM produced machines to count the number of dead. Many German companies now, BMW is one of them, were involved in manufacturing and making machines to kill. Feeling guilty isn't actually a positive action. There's no point in being guilty. What's much more important is understanding how it came about. Because if we are feeling guilty or we are in a situation, then we are stuck down in an environment which is not going to evolve us. It is better to say that that will never happen again, because human consciousness has evolved beyond that. So, I can't tell you how many millions died. I can tell you that there was a plan to establish Israel. That is true. There was a very deep-rooted plan to create a country for the Jews, over and above what is normally told to the public. I have seen politicians in Germany destroyed because they appeared to deny the Holocaust. And I have seen politicians in Germany who have been misunderstood in what they said, forced to resign, because it is such a powerful subject that nobody dares criticize that. People will lose their jobs. It's incredible. You know, you could make a comment about a black person and get away with it. But if you make a comment about a Jewish person, you're unlikely to get away with it. That's already inequality across the country and across the world. So Jews are very powerful people. But is it the fact they're Jewish, or is it the fact that they bond to a group which ultimately is controlled by Zionism?
Yeah. Yeah.
Could you say every German was bad, or would you say only the Schutzstaff, the SS, were bad? Where do you put the finger? Where do you draw the line? All of this is pointless. This doesn't help us. We need to go forward and say, that is a lesson. The only good thing from it is to learn from it and to say, never again. That's my answer to you.
Thank you very much. It makes things more clear, although I don't know whether the answer helps a lot in the sense that it confirms that this horrible thing happens. I mean, in that amount, in that extension, let's say, but anyway. You were talking that that was the experience and so on. So that leads to my second question. I mean, I don't know how many. And that would be that, but first I have to start, like, we know that there are beings, and you mentioned that before also, women being made pregnant and then the baby disappears or whatever. Also, I think we know that there are beings that are created, hybrids, let's say, and that they are brought to other planets. I have heard a gentleman lately say that these beings, and we heard that before already, are brought to other planets and they are seen like precious things. But in this case, I heard that they are treated like gods, these hybrids, let's say, so half humans or whatever. And they go, in fact, to planets where they treat the others as slaves. So I have heard also, and we have read, I guess, about all these other planets that are going a little bit through the, let's say, prison planets. And I was just wondering, is there ever going to be an end to this situation? Are we like forerunners in this experiment? If we succeed through all this pain and all, I mean, whatever we have experienced during all our lifetimes, isn't it enough like to feed all the libraries of the universe? Have we suffered enough, the whole world as a whole, you know, to just put an end to this experiment and, you know, free the planet? And we understand, we know that we are God's experience itself through us. But it, as my consciousness, my soul, whatever, says, no, it's enough. Can't I mean, I'm doing that every day. I just command, it's enough. I have enough of this. So what do you see? I mean, what do you see beside, I mean, beyond this planet that we are?
Right, but the thing is that you are a creator, not just other idiots. You create reality out of thought. The second point is that slavery was in your country, as it was in my country, but we have evolved beyond that. The third point is that this situation that we're in has had to be this bad because it, so many people are so resilient to change and are so deeply enrooted in what they believe to be true that the stimulus is being applied has to be greater and greater. If I have a pin and you put your finger and I stick a pin in your finger which you don't move, I'm going to push that pin further until you move. So the situation we have on this planet is because everyone is so asleep. It is becoming intolerable because your nerve endings are so awake and alive that you are feeling this pain now. But the person down the street whose finger is not alive is actually being pushed through. You are feeling the pain, all of you are feeling the pain for everybody because you are all connected. The consciousness is connected. But you came here for a reason. And I say to people, don't give up now. Because if you give up now, the work you were doing falls to the rest of us.
Slave planets will go on until they go through the same thing and probably forever and ever?
No. The important thing is that individually, if we do not achieve what we need to achieve, we will come back here and carry on. But as a group, the consciousness must rise to a level that we no longer need to be in this environment. The lesson has been learned, but it's not learned by enough people. So once that lesson is learned by enough people, it will be over. But we move on to the next stage, where the challenges will be different, but our understanding and our learning will be higher. So we will slowly build up our understanding and our ability to cope with situations. This is the hardest one. The third dimension, this is, that's why Jesus came here. This was where it was needed. This is where it's fought out on an individual basis every day. And remember this, every person that smiles, every person that laughs, every person that gives a beggar a dollar, that love doesn't just come out from you onto this planet. It goes beyond into the multiverse and creates a ripple effect. It's like the rock in the pool and the ripples going out. That good intent, that decision to do something positive changes other people. You can't see them, but that consciousness changes the level. And so when we as a group start to do good, we begin to build up a massive force of goodness that cannot be stopped. It's a critical mass. It's what makes the scales tick. That's what we're looking for. So we have to go, because we came here to do a job, and we cannot go home until that job is done, because otherwise we don't just betray ourselves, we betray all of those who can't do it. The 2-year-old baby, the 90-year-old woman, the disabled person, all those people who cannot stand beside us but wish they could. So we are a standard bearer, not just for ourselves, but for anything that stands on the side of goodness. That is what we are doing here.
But we not only believe, but we know. Yeah, thank you. One last thing, what do you think about our immortality now? I mean, from now on, in this lifetime, becoming immortals?
We talked about the pharaohs. The pharaohs seeked immortality. But they sought it through physical immortality. They believed that if they preserved their bodies, they would then live forever. Even in the highest realms, you don't live forever. You can clone your body, you can do what you want, but you don't live in the soul and body forever. Only one creature lived forever, and that is God. Everybody else is time limited. On the physical side. But the soul lives forever, but the soul will inhabit different bodies. The problem is that we are conditioned to look at different people, and all we see is the face. If anybody here has seen a dead person or a dead animal that you know, you will look at that dead body and you know the person isn't there anymore. The face actually changes, because when a soul is in a body, it animates the face. There is an energy that is given off. And when you look at the departed, those that have passed on, there is something missing. And that is the spark of life. So we don't want immortality physically, because that also brings stagnation. We need to evolve and change, but our bodies are a reflection of who we are inside. We are immortal, we just inhabit bodies that don't last very long.
Yeah. Personally, I don't think that we get stagnated in our own body, because we can't evolve with our body. And I remember now that you don't accept the concept of ascended masters, for example. but I don't want to continue. I mean, if you want to say maybe more today.
Yes.
Oh. Okay, so thank you very much.